How many bags do you guys need? Five, six?
One, but that one's too big.
Welcome back to the West Coast Bass Pro-Am on the California Delta. I'm Justin Wolf. It was a tougher bite than most people expected on day one, but still there was a few big bass being wrestled out of the live wells.
Just flipping.
While no one hit 30 pounds for a limit, 11 limits of over 20 pounds were weighed in, some helped by big fish like Mark Shelley's 8.95 pounder that ended up being the second big fish behind Nick Welton's 909 big bass of the day.
You were sleeping on me, Ike. 22.31 pounds.
With over 22 pounds, Wayne Brazil locked up third place, right behind Rick Rudd in second with 23.5 pounds.
Holy cow. Oh, we got a new leader. 26.35
And with an impressive 26-plus pound bag, Mike Folkstad has a solid lead going into day two.
Just a second here. Non-boater big fish, calling the big fish.
652.
Not bad. 6.52. 652. Good job, Randy.
And then we waited for the tide to change. Once the tide changed, I had an area where I knew the big ones were. And if they bid, I knew we'd get some good fish and we'd get them four good ones.
The next morning was greeted by the national anthem, which is a West Coast bass tradition. With day two underway, it really is anyone's tournament to win or lose. But there is one particular angler in today's tournament that stands out, not only as likely to cash a check, but also as one of the truly historical figures of the bass fishing world.
We finally chased down one of the legends, one of the best fishermen we've had in our sport, Mr. Thomas. He's sitting right over there doing what he invented to begin with, was flipping.
Dee Thomas is known as the father of flipping, a fishing technique that became so popular it created its own micro-industry within the fishing industry, and its own vernacular that today we take for granted. Today we flip for fish with a flipping stick when there's a good flip bite, and we owe that to Dee Thomas. Earlier, I had the opportunity to spend some time on the Delta with Dee, where he gave me the details of how flipping began.
I caught my first black bass when I was 18 years old on Whiskey Sloop. Never forget it. I caught my second one when I was probably 20 with a friend of mine, Tan Tanquary, who's done passed on, when I was probably 20 years old. Those two fish started me on my venture for black bass. I used to be an avid striper fisherman, but it just didn't hold the thrill that a 6 or 7 pound black gave me. You don't know about the flipping technique. It all started back in 1974, the first tournament I ever fished. I fished with a two-leaded stick. And that's what flipping stemmed off of, was tule dipping. The guys that started tule dipping in California was a fellow named O.C. McGee and Claude Davis. Those are the guys that originated the tule dipping stuff. Those were the guys that showed me how to do it. They showed me the equipment that I needed to do it with. There he is. That's a good one, too. That's a good one.
How flipping grew out of tule dipping is a long story. But basically, Dee was doing extremely well in tournaments with a 12-foot dipping stick, and that was upsetting the other anglers so badly that it forced a particular tournament director to ask Dee if he would accept the length limit on rods in order to keep the peace. Dee agreed and suggested 7.5 feet as the length limit.
He's over 4 pounds. So I says, make it a 7.5 foot rod. This is okay. Because I'd taken a striper stick off the wall of my garage and I started dabbing around in the garage there to see if I could do it. And I thought I could get it done. Well, I go to the lake or the Delta, wherever I went, I don't remember. And I took that rod and I tried to do it like that. And I thought, man, this is really a pain because it wasn't working very good. So then what I did, as I took that line and I pulled some out like that, I dropped it down, kept pulling it down, and then I got a pendulum flame. Oh, I could get out there a little further. And this rod here is only about 7 foot long. Well, that rod that I was using about 7.5. As you notice, I can get over pretty good. And that's when flipping was born. And what I try to do is I try to keep my jig alive. You hear about these guys that dead stick it. I don't fish like that. I'm making something happen with that jig all the time. But the key is to get the right movement of what you want that jig to do. No, what that fish wants that jig to do. And you're trying to emulate what he's going to eat. So I keep working with it, fishing different ways. Sometimes I'll hop it. Sometimes I'll drag it. And right now, I've been just barely bumping it up off the bottom. I try to keep it as close to the bottom as I can and still make my rattles work. That's what I try to do. Trying to pull the fish, trying to antagonize him and make him bite. This last spring, the only way I could get bit was moving the bait in a very gentle motion. And during the FLW National Guard Tournament, the first day I had 33 pounds. Every one of them was caught on a jig. Tides, let's talk about the tides out here a little bit. I think, personally, people put too much stock in the tides. The fish got to be a runner someplace. I don't care how low or how high the tide is. The only time I think that the fish may not be readily accessible to is when the tide gets real high and they back off up in that stuff up there, the tules and stuff. Then they get back in there where you can't get to them. But when it's low tide like this, there are one or two places. They're either out just a little bit or they're down on the breaks where they're at. And I think the bulk of the fish with these cold fronts that's gone through are out on the breaks where they're at. And that's slow fishing, and you don't cover very much water when you do it. The only time tides come into play for me is I'm keying on a high water bite, and then I'll take and I'll run the high water. Sometimes you want low water where you can see what you're fishing. So, but as far as the importance of them, I don't put the stock in and everybody else puts in. The way I feel about the Delta, if you're going to fish the Delta, you need to learn the area that you're fishing in on both high water and low water. And if you'll do that, you'll always get your fish. That's that big fish you want. Thanks for coming out and spending a day with me. Appreciate it. I'll see you guys down the line.